Hello there, listening and watching friends. This is Pastor Dennis Finnan, coming your way with a special internet broadcast of a House for His Name electronic church service. Now, we're trying as best we can to allow you to worship in your home with some Christian music, some prayers, and for you to learn more of God's wonderful Word. Now, gathering in your home during the virus crisis is acceptable to God for His commandment to worship together. So stay with me now as I begin this Sunday service from our church facility for your enjoyment and communion with the Lord Jesus Christ. Hi there, friends. This is Dennis Finnan, pastor of A House for His Name. You know, as COVID-19 stay-at-home recommendations continue to lessen, area businesses and churches are getting ready to open up once again, and so are we. We do realize that not everybody will feel comfortable at this time coming back to church, but we're going to continue our internet worship services designed with you in mind. And of course, singing is a core value of Christianity, and we want to include that in our worship today. We'll begin with a beautiful hymn I think everyone loves to sing. It's entitled, How Firm a Foundation, and that will fit my message today as well. Let's sing along now in the comfort of your home. I hope you enjoyed that hymn. And now before my message, let's sing another song, a bit updated, of course, to our present generation. It's entitled, Where Truth and Mercy Meet.
Lord, you see me through your mercy. Still you love me. In your kindness there is justice. Through your goodness you have brought me here, where truth and mercy meet. You triumph over me. Your love has won my heart again, and still I'm so amazed. My guilt is washed away before your cross of peace. where truth and mercy meet. King of glory, Lord of mercy, risen Savior, perfect wonder. Through your kindness, you have drawn me. By your suffering, you have saved me. Here, where truth and mercy meet, be triumphed over me. Your love has won my heart again, and still I am so amazed. My guilt is washed away before your cross of peace, where truth and mercy meet. Where truth and mercy meet, you triumph over me. Your love has won my heart again, and still I am so amazed. My guilt is washed away before your cross of peace, where truth and mercy. Where truth and mercy meet, you triumph over me. Your love has won my heart again, and still I am so amazed. My guilt is washed away before your cross of peace, where truth and mercy. Where truth and mercy meet.
Well, now we've sung to the Lord our joy and praise of his great salvation through our Savior Jesus Christ. So now it's time to study about him and his word. And we're in the book of Hebrews, and we come to what is one of my favorite chapters, chapter 11. I've entitled my message, God's Hall of Fame, Part 1. Let's begin. Hello again, everyone, and thank you for listening and watching us today. In our studies of Hebrews, we come to perhaps one of the most exciting, dramatic portions of Scripture found in the Word of God. We're going to examine and explore the practical aspect of what it means to believe in God. And we could sum it up in one word, faith, the most misunderstood word in English history, I would guess. But now, here in our text today, God puts on display a sampling of not all, but some great people of the past in the kingdom of God. And we're going to look at them. Now, I've entitled my message, God's Hall of Fame, Part 1, because we are not going to just go very quickly through the book of Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to spend some time in there, and I think you're going to see it. Now, I'm sure there are many nameless and faceless people that are not included in Hebrews 11, but they are not unknown to God, of course. And one day they will stand out and be highly rewarded in the kingdom of heaven for their great work of serving our God and Savior Jesus Christ. But for now, God wants us to examine in chapter 11, He wants us to examine 16 people. I had to think about that for a second here. And out of these 16 people, there are men and women who did great things for the Lord. And I feel we should take note of for that. So over the number of weeks ahead, we're going to dig in, shall we say, mine the Word of God and dig out some gems that will enable you to be strong in your faith. And if you have no faith, to enter in and find faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So let's begin again by hearing the Word of God read for us. This time again, we're using a dramatic reading of Scripture, and that will follow me as we prepare for teaching and preaching the Word of God. So now let's listen to the Word as it is spoken.
Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offerings. And by faith, Abel still speaks, even though he is dead. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God had taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that is in keeping with faith.
All right, let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the word that we've received. Now we're going to open that word and study it in depth, and I pray that you will indeed encourage and excite and challenge all who will be listening. I pray especially, Lord, if there's anyone under the sound of your word today who doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Savior, and every one of us was there once, long ago perhaps, but nonetheless, we were there. I pray that you will open that heart and their eyes to see Jesus clearly and to respond and call upon him to be their Lord, their God, and their Savior. We pray especially for all of us who do know Jesus Christ, that will gain higher ground in our walk of faith because of our reading and study of the Word of God today. This we pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, we're going to look at two things. It's pretty simple to break down these seven verses. The first is the requiem of faith, firmly defined in the first three verses. And then we're going to have the response of faith, the fruitful display, of course, that we find in three men of ancients in the past, in verses 4 to 7. So let's begin with the first and second verse. Notice on the screen, I'm going to read it for you again. Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. So now the writer starts right off to show the Hebrew Christians. Remember, he was writing to a group of believers in the first century around 50 to 60 AD. And we don't know where they were. They were somewhere in Asia Minor. And they were not in big mega churches as we have today. I've said that many times. They were in small house churches, little groups of people, perhaps somewhere between 8 to 10, maybe even there might have been 30, 35 who would be able to gather in some wealthy person's home. But nonetheless, they were house churches. So the writer starts right off, and he starts to speak about what was important to the Christians of that day, and particularly Hebrews who had come out of Judaism and had become believers. You know, as he looked back on their original faith, and it was his faith as well. We believe he was a Hebrew Christian who wrote this. The system of religion that they had, the performance of it, and the purpose of it, of course, was for one purpose. It was to guide the people of Israel to look forward by faith, there's that word, so that they would remember that God was going to save them. And this whole process of Judaism was the method by which he would save their souls. So to sum it up, we're going to talk about one word today, and that's the word faith. And Christianity, like Judaism, that had to look forward by faith, to be saved, we look back by faith that we were saved in the coming of Jesus Christ. Everything in both systems requires faith. Everything in both systems operates by faith. For the follower and the blessings that God designs for us to receive now in this life, and of course that in eternity. Now, faith is a little word, but it's also a big word. You have to think about that, because actually, whether you're a believer in Christ or not, everybody lives by faith. You might say, really? Yes, that's really true. I'm going to show you this. I'm going to put it up on the screen for you here. We all live daily by faith. Number one, you start your day with faith. You perhaps go to a job, you get into a car, or you drive to work, or you trust the manufacturer has built a safe and reliable vehicle that will keep you that way until you get to your work and take you home again. Everything in that concern is by faith. Number two, think about this. You walk into a building, maybe if you're in a big area, a big skyscraper, you trust those who created, from the architect to the contractor who built it to the workmen who were involved in putting everything together, that it doesn't fall down and kill you. Another way of faith, you mail a credit card payment. Maybe you make a bank deposit, and by faith you expect it to get there, or at least to be there for you in the bank after you've made that deposit. And number four is another way of faith, that every day you exercise, you perhaps go to a doctor or you submit to an operation, and by faith you expect to be made well by the doctor and the nurses and the staff and their equipment. Everything functions as it should so that you will get well. And one more, of course, all these things require a serious faith that you will not be ruined, that you will not be harmed, you will not be killed in your daily walk of life. And you can only benefit from any of these things that we're talking about in our everyday life by you stepping out your front door and exercising faith that they will be there. Well, God's salvation is on the same principle. Think about this. I want to give you five things. God has promised to save us. You must believe that by faith. He has provided the way through a substitute sacrifice and payment for our sins. You must believe that. He sent his son, Jesus Christ, to die for us, which he did. You must believe that. God the Father says that he accepted Christ's death on your behalf. You must believe that. And that God will apply his sin payment to your account for all eternity as you received his gift of forgiveness. You have to believe that. That's what Christianity is all about, faith. And it's not a hard thing when you get down to it. So God then tells us it's ours, and the only requirement is faith to believe God. Now let's get back to that verse, all right? Now the writer of Hebrews is saying this is the kind of faith in your God and in your salvation that is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. So to believe God is the beginning step to bring an awakening moment. Think about that, that God loves you, that he has a divine place for you in the future economy, and it is filled with multiple blessings, and God will reserve a place especially for you when we pass this earthly life. And most blessed of all, once we receive God's offer in this life, it can never be lost, it can never be canceled, it can never be taken away. I think of Alex Trebek, the guy who sells insurance on TV, and he always promises everyone who buys this insurance policy that it'll never be lost or canceled. Well, never mind about earthly insurance policies. God has given you an eternal insurance policy. And what is it based on? It's not based on your hope-so. It's based on your know-so that the one who is giving this promise is going to carry it out and has the ability and the power to do that very thing. So thus, faith is confidence in a sense, right? To invest everything you have and are to see this promiser, who is God, for his future benefits to accrue to you. And of course, that offerer, that promiser, is the Creator God, who will unreservedly and assuredly accomplish it because he's promised to do that very thing. We've been studying that all these past weeks, and it is in the fact that God has struck a covenant with you, that he is the promiser of that covenant, and he will do it. But nonetheless, think of this. Faith operates on a no-see basis, and for now, a no-receive. You don't get the benefits right now for you. So this faith is on that. Now, like all faith, think about that. It trusts in the supplier. It trusts in the provider. It trusts in the promiser that he will bring these things to about. And what is necessary for you is that for you to benefit by this Creator God is to trust in who he is and what he has done. And that's important. Faith is confidence in what we hope for, something we don't have, and assurance about what we do not see. And all the ancients who were believers, they were commended that they exercised that faith and that faith pleased God. So this is what we're studying about today. Now, the Jewish Christians in the first century house churches there, they were particularly, many of them were fence straddlers. We talked about that. They had made a profession of faith, but it didn't go any further because they were not ready to trust their lives to this one who was called Jesus Christ. And yet there were many in that house church who were true believers, and they had gone all the way with Jesus and received the blessings. So these fence straddlers were the kind of people who say, I'll see it, I'll believe it when I see it. Think about that. And the images that they look back to in Judaism that got them going was the colorful and glorious priesthood, the sacrificial altar, the sweet-smelling incense that flowed up from the altar in the tabernacle. And then by day, they looked at the tabernacle from afar off, and they saw this giant cloud that went all the way into the stratosphere. That was because that was God had come to be with them in their tabernacle. And then at night, there was this fire in the sky that warmed them. In the desert there, the temperatures went down to zero, but not them. They had a comfortable 60, 70 degrees. God warmed them at night, and he shielded them with a cloud by day so they weren't burned to death in the desert. They had all these things that they could see for this God, but they were gone now. And so what do we have in Christianity? We don't have all of or any of those things. You know, some Christians today try to manufacture them through miracle working things and those of that sort. But we don't have that. But we do have something that the people of old did not have. And that is that all true believers experience it. Simple true faith for us brings God's gift of what? A new life that God places within the sinner, to spiritually see God's sure and real promises afar off, but awaiting for us. In other words, your faith is a spiritual sight, and God gives you the enablement to see it. Now, what is this new life he places in us? In the Bible, we call it being born again. You know, you were physically born from your mother, and you were given life through the growing within her womb. Well, God gives another life, which is not an alternate life. It's you or me. God gives us a new birth. And we're reborn into the kingdom of God. And what a wonderful thing it is. So we don't see anything afar off. We may not see anything in this life. We may even see the opposite of things that are good and great. But that new life in you looks beyond and says, I see it. I see it. It's waiting for me. All I need to do is live by faith and trust the Lord to accomplish all these very things. So what a wonderful thing it is. So think about this here now. We must make note, although not mentioned here, this faith alone to believe must first be exercised to see. Now some people say, well, you know, if I see it, I'll believe it. And that's very true. In life, we follow that. The world's faith is seeing is believing. But you know what the Bible faith is? God's faith is believing will create seeing. So if you're waiting to see, you'll never come to faith in Jesus Christ. You must believe who he is, what he did, and what he has given you and promises you, and step out by faith with confidence in what you hope for and assurance about what you do not see. That is the requiem of true faith design. It really is important. Now, what is it we are required to believe? Let's take a look at this here and we'll see it. Look at verse 3. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what is visible. Now, we cannot believe what God requires of us to be saved until we first believe, and I've said this three times already, who God is and what he has done. And the writer says that. By faith, we understand what? That the universe was created by God. Now, that's really important here. God is the creator. God is the originator of all things material and invisible that exists. Now, today, cosmogonists, got that out correctly, they maintain the universe either evolved out of or simply formed out of some singular dense material that was floating somewhere in something. And out of that, it is called the Big Bang, that everything that is here is there. They don't see any God or anything like that. But God's word tells us that's not true. God's word says the universe was created. Actually, it tells us it was created out of nothing. Now, what we're doing here in the church through the internet and putting these messages on the internet is a creation. But we're creating this out of all kinds of materials. I have a camera that is focusing on me. We're going to put this through the intricacies of the internet and produce a visual image for you to see on a television screen or on your computer or listen on your iPod or your iPhone or some source of that for that purpose. But we're doing all these things out of existing materials. God didn't do that. God created everything, the Latin is ex nihilo, out of nothing. Now that's important there. And notice what it says, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible here. There was no matter, there was no pre-existing materials. God simply spoke his mind and his word, and it all appeared. Isn't that amazing? That's the kind of God you need to believe in, a God who can do even that as well. So for within, God did, once he created the universe and he created all the planets and the stars, he zeroed in on one singular planet that was null and void. And out of that, he began to form over the six-day period of the initial creation of building the universe as well. He formed everything that is on this planet now as well. So think about that very thing there. A single planet in the created universe, God zeroed in on. Now, whether you believe it or not, this omnipotent, eternal, ever-living God put you and me right here as everyone else is as well. So think about all these things, because the Bible tells us in Revelation 4:11, you are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. And why is that? Notice what it says. For you, O God, created all things. In other words, there's nothing in existence that God didn't create. So to say that God created everything out of nothing is correct. And by your will, they were created and they have their being. Now, notice what it says about this creation that was formed at God's command. So that what is seen was not made out of what is visible. Now, I don't know about you, but the writer of Hebrews now is speaking by special revelation. What I mean by that is he's speaking something he could have not known anything about. It had to be given to him by God himself. He speaks of issues completely unknown to humanity, even for 1,000 years. And that is, the universe is made up of, guess what we've discovered? Actually, microscopic particles called matter or atoms or molecules, whatever it is there. You know, I sat down this week thinking, all right, so everything is made up of atoms. In other words, you can look and see something that looks solid. You could even look at a mountain and granite. But if you could get into it close enough with an electron microscope, you discover that it's not a solid piece. It's made up of all little intricate things that are floating together called atoms. Now, I thought about that and I said, all right, that means that I'm also not a solid existence. I'm made up of all kinds of molecules and atoms. How many atoms is in the human body? Well, scientists have taken this step to try to work this out. Now, they can't be absolutely positive, but they say the human body contains 7 to the 27th power. That is the number 7 and 27 zeros. I can't even say the number. It's so great. This is so big, but that's how many atoms are in one human being. But what did he say? This is what the world and the universe and everything in it was made out of, that which is invisible. It's not visible to the human eye. So the term it refers to is matter. So by faith, we must first come to accept and believe what God says, that the eternal, self-existent one in his omnipotence created everything that exists out of nothing. And although we could look down to the very atoms there made, it's still the created matter of God. And of course, that's what it says in Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God, bara, created the heavens and the earth. All of this exists. So you can go on believing that everything just came about by some big bang theory of some piece of matter floating around in nothing, but it doesn't matter. God made these things. And if you're going to come to faith in God, there's no way to believe in God unless you believe in the creation of the universe by God himself. But now, let's move back to our text. We move to verse 4, because now we see the response of faith displayed. We're going to spend some time here. We're going to look at three characters. By faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. By faith, he was commended as righteous when God spoke well of his offering. And by faith, Abel still speaks even though he's dead. Here were two men who were the early children of Adam and Eve. The first was Cain, and the second known boy was Abel. Cain decided that he was going to till the ground and be a farmer. Nothing wrong. God was very happy with Cain being a farmer. But at the same time, Abel decided that he was going to be a rancher, and he would herd sheep around, and therefore he had access, of course, to these sheep because there was the call by God to have a sacrifice. Now we're going to get into this a bit here. Now, we're going to be shown how their faith existed and what it did for them and can do for you and for me as well. Now, the first was Abel, and you could go back to the book of Genesis chapter 4, verse 1, and find that he was the second notable son of Adam and Eve. Now, we are not told, and we need to think about this, we are not told how many other sons Adam and Eve had, and whether they had other sons between Abel and Cain. We just take for granted that Abel came next. But think about this here for a minute, because we're going to do a little speculation about this very thing. Again, notice Genesis 4. Adam made love to his wife Eve. What a wonderful thing that is. They were the first married couple. But anyway, later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now note that word later. The word later means after a long period of time. So what did they do for a long period of time? Were they celibate? I doubt that, because they enjoyed each other as they should. And of course, having the ability to procreate, and God said to them that they were to procreate all over the earth and put mankind there. I'm sure they were working on that night and day whenever they had a chance. But anyway, later she gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. We just said that. Now look at chapter 5, verse 3. When Adam had lived 130 years, he had a son in his own image or likeness, and he named him Seth. So now this is the third son that the Bible notes. Now make understanding of this. We're not told everything about what went on in the bedroom of Adam and Eve, and we're not told anything about the length of time that all these things went on, except here's the clue. 130 years later, they had a third son, and his name was Seth. Now, in a 130-year period, I repeat, do you think Adam and Eve were celibate? No. They continued to obey God and multiply. And that is, they had other children, because the Bible tells us something about when Abel and Cain had the confrontation and Cain killed Abel, Cain went off with his wife and started having children of their own that we know of. Who was Cain's wife? Obviously, it had to be one of his sisters. So in other words, they continued to have children. I believe they had other sons. I believe they had other daughters. But they were not in the line that would bring the Savior and come through Noah. And so Moses was instructed by God to just highlight those people who would be in the line that produced the Savior in the future. But now let me just think about that. So if Adam and Eve continued to have children, in this 130-year period, think about that now, how many did they have? Well, I figured out that they could have had perhaps 200 other children. Think about that. And how do I come to that conclusion? Well, today, the average is of a couple that continues to copulate, that they have usually children that are separated by 2 or 3 years. I'll do you one better. My brother and I are only 11 months apart. So you can imagine how many children could have been born in 130 years. And I believe they did. So they must have had many other sons and daughters. In fact, intermarriage was very common, and it was permitted, do you realize, for 2,500 years until Moses, by God's permission, had written in Leviticus 18:10 that no longer were they to intermarry brothers and sisters and cousins of that nature there. And why was that? Well, they began to see, or at least God knew, that because of sin, the human race was breaking down genetically. And all this close intermarriage here would bring a lot of genetic problems, as today we know that as a matter of fact. It's even worse today than it was at that particular time. So keep that in mind here, the human genetic disorder breakdown. Now, by faith, Abel brought God a better offering than Cain did. Why was his offering better than Cain's? It was better because it was the only picture that could save them from their sins. God said, the soul that sins shall die. We went over this in weeks past. And therefore, the only thing that could pay for your sin was your death. That's what God said. You have sinned, you must pay for your sin with your death. But God then said, I'm going to make a change. I'm going to allow that someone else can die for your sins. Now, the blood of bulls and goats can never pay for your sin, but I'm going to do, through the process of covering your sins, enable you to exist so that you will not die for your sins. And so early on, God spoke to Adam and Eve, and Adam and Eve trained their children that they had to bring a worship offering of a blood sacrifice, because that's the only thing that could cover their sins until God himself could take away their sins by the Lamb of God that would come. So Abel did this. But Cain didn't like that. He didn't like the messiness of a blood offering. He didn't want to go to his brother and buy a sheep or goat and offer it there. So he decided, I'm going to bring what I think is good enough. And he brought the best of the field, thought it was good enough. And God said to him, no, Cain, you know what is right. You need to do what is right, and everything will be right. And Cain refused and shook his fist in the face of God and said, I don't need to do what you want. I'm going to go my own way. And God let him go his own way. And of course he did. And he took one of his, the sisters, of course, of Adam and Eve, and married her, and they went off and started to build their own kingdom of people, which are known as the godless people. Just read chapter 5 of Genesis sometime for that very thing there. But we're only talking about those who followed what Abel did. Abel was faithful, and in that faithfulness, he did that. Now, let's look at three people. We're going to look at three people in the process here because they're important. There's three types of faith being exhibited in verses 4 to 7. Abel, Enoch, and Noah. Very simple. We're going to see that Abel is a picture of faith worshiping. And it's important to see that because I've taken this from Warren Wiersbe's commentary, and I thought it was so wonderfully put up, but I'll add to it in the process. Abel is a picture of faith worshiping. Enoch is an example of faith walking. And Noah is an example of faith working. If you have your outline sheet and you've printed it out, you can write all these things on there and follow along as we do. So let's break this down now, all right? Genesis 4, verses 2 to 4. Later, she, that is Eve, gave birth to his brother Abel. Now Abel kept the flocks and Cain worked the soil. Now in the Hebrew, this word later means, I said it before, much later. A considerable amount of time went by before Abel was born. There may have been other sons and other daughters, we don't know. And there probably were. But nonetheless, Abel was the one that is being noted because God noted him. Now Abel kept flocks and Cain worked the soil. Now look at verse 3. This is an important thing. In the course of time, Cain brought some fruit of the soil as an offering to the Lord. I put on the screen in outline, in the course of time. That literally means in the Hebrew, at the end of days. In other words, it was the end of some period of days. We don't know what that is, but we can imagine. And what does it say here? Verse 4, Abel also brought an offering of fat portions. That meant he brought the best piece of meat from his flock for some of the firstborn of his flock. And the Lord looked with favor on Abel's offering. Now, this continuing of time, much time, is important. When Abel was born, Adam and Eve named him, of course. And you know what the name Abel means? Abel means vanity. Abel means vapor, like something that is just going to pass away. Why would Eve name Abel that? The answer is very simple. Because of the destructive effects of God's curse on the world in which they lived. So right now, think about this. She's already experienced the vanity of life. She knows all these things, and now Abel's coming along, so she names him after that. Romans 8:20 says in the New Living Translation, against its will, that is, all creation was subject to God's curse, or the King James calls it vanity. So in the course of time, literally the Hebrew means at the end of days. What were these end of days? Think about that now. It's really important to think about that. It was the end of a week, probably. I want to read to you from Henry Morris's Defender's Study Bible. I like what he says because I agree with him 100%. He writes, and I quote, undoubtedly, this is a reference to the seventh day, which God had hallowed as a day of rest and blessing, Genesis 2:3. On such a day, Adam's family would follow God's example in ceasing from their regular labors in order to have fellowship with God. And possibly they met with him at the entrance to Eden, Genesis 3:24, which was the gateway to heaven on earth. That's right. Paradise was heaven on earth. Adam and Eve no doubt had instructed their sons and daughters that to meet God, this required a substitutionary sacrifice of death, representing them and their sins, Genesis 3:21. I couldn't have said it better than that. So it appears Cain was a man, as I said, of his own mind and didn't want to give the blood offering. He wanted nothing to do with that. And he chose to change that and show his kindness and bring the fruit of the land. But what did God say? By faith, Abel brought a better offering than Cain did. And rightly worshiped, the Bible says he brought a better offering for two reasons. Think about this. Number one, it was the only type of sacrifice God could accept. And it was the right sacrifice because it was a blood sacrifice. Leviticus 7:11 says that very thing, that it is only by the blood that God can accept you for the forgiveness of sins. Hebrews 9:22 talks about that as well. God reprimanded Cain in the process and told him to do what is right. Genesis 4:7, if you do what is right, Cain, will you not be accepted? But Cain didn't want anything with that. So it was the right sacrifice. And the second thing is it was brought with faith. We're back to that word, right? God told Abel to bring a blood sacrifice, and by faith, Abel obeyed. So the expression is important. Someone once said, dead men tell no tales. Well, that's not right. Dead men do tell tales, and this is the dead man. His name is Abel, and he tells a tale right here, which is correct. He speaks from the grave, and he talks about three progressive things. Think about this. Number one, he had a better sacrifice, and because he brought a better sacrifice, it brought him true righteousness before God. And because he was truly righteous before God, it became a witness to the world around him. Now, what did it bring Abel for this witness? It made him a martyr for his faith, because the anti-God or the godless one, which was Cain, slew him because he did that very thing. And you know, that still goes on to this day. Those who will follow the true faith of God and testify to that before others in many godless countries, they'll be killed for their faith. So by faith, a better offering Abel brought than Cain did. Now, Abel indeed represents the best of humanity's obedience to God. And Abel sets the standard from way back in the beginning of creation, all the way through time, even to our day here. The way back to God can only come through a blood sacrifice. Your way back to God from your sin and disobedience and walking away from God can only come when you accept the sacrifice of His Son, Jesus Christ, who offered up His life. It's called the blood sacrifice for the sins of the world. Now, notice something else about Abel. Abel didn't just offer this sacrifice anywhere. He offered it at the altar. Where did Adam and Eve, and where did Abel and those who were faithful and righteous build this altar? Probably near the Garden of Eden. Remember, the Garden of Eden was still on the earth until the flood came. Now, there were angels guarding the way in, so nobody went in there without being slew and killed. So they stayed away. They were cautious about that very thing. But I'm sure that was the place where they went and went to thank God for promising to save them in the future to come here. So Abel is a witness from the beginning era of time. And he is a picture of what? Faith worshiping. How beautiful it is. So let me ask you, are you a believer in Christ? If so, have you followed his example? How faithful are you in worshiping God? Now, right, well, now we have trouble with this COVID-19 and houses of worship are closed. We're opening them up. We're going to open our church too, but we have to go through some hoopla from the state to do that very thing. But you know what? We're going to obey because we're obedient Christians, and we're going to follow their principles, and we're going to open the church, hopefully, on, let's see, it would be June 12th. It may be a little bit later. It all depends on the state and their faithfulness of giving us the permit to offer for us to do that. But churches are opening their doors again, and we will have faith. But it's important to remember all these things here, that God wants you to be a man or a woman of faith. And if you'll do that, God will be pleased with you too. Now, this brings us in the response of faith displayed that the writer brings us to a man named Enoch. This is a beautiful example. Look at verse 5. By faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death. He could not be found because God has taken him away. For before he was taken, he was commended as one who pleased God. Isn't that beautiful here? We come to the second man of faith. This Enoch, by the way, is not, there's two Enochs in the Old Testament, in the book of Genesis. In Genesis 4:17, there is another Enoch, but he is a descendant of Cain, and we're not interested in the godless ones. But what we have is the God-filled one right here, and we have to consider that. Enoch, I'm going to show you in a little bit of time here, maintained his faith and in his family all the way down to Noah. So actually, our families too can be the true testimony of a faith that lives in you and me. Now, the Bible speaks of godly Enoch descended from the godly man who was Seth. And the first thing we learn about Seth is in Genesis 4:26, it says, "Then people began to call upon the name of the Lord." It's an interesting phrase. What it means is, then people began to publicly gather together to worship the Lord. It wasn't individual worship or just family worship. It was now families worshiping the Lord together. Seth instituted this, and Seth began to bring about what we do today, even thousands and thousands of years later. And what happened from Seth? Seth and his family were faithful to God, and they passed on their faith to five men who ended, with Enoch here. Enoch lived on the earth, it says, for 365 years. We're going to see that in a moment here. And then God took him. It's really important. Now, let's go back to Genesis 5:24 to read that. When Enoch had lived 65 years, he became the father of Methuselah. After he became the father of Methuselah, Enoch walked faithfully with God 300 years and had other sons and daughters. Now again, mind you, We're told now that there were other sons and daughters that we're not told anything about. They lived and died. Altogether, Enoch lived a total of 365 years. Enoch walked faithfully with God, then was no more because God took him away. That's what the writer of Hebrews looks back in the book of Genesis and tells us here. And the Bible speaks of this very thing here. Enoch lived 365 years. You know what the average lifespan of a human being at this time before the flood was? Upwards of 900 years. People try to explain that away and say, oh, they had a different way of figuring years. That's nonsense. The same way they figured years to then, we figure years today. Solar days. But the important thing was, they lived that long because the human race was planned for that. But sin came in, and now sin is slowly destroying the human race and human bodies. So that we're lucky we live 70 today. But that's how it was back then. So if he only lived 365 years, his life was literally cut in half. God cut his life in half. But God didn't do it to cut his life in half. God did it to bless him. He was commended as one who pleased God, verse 5. So let's ask, what did his faith do to please God? So let's go over it. Enoch was an example of faith walking. He walked his faith before everybody else. He allowed it to be seen among people. And this is what pleased God. Here's the first thing. Enoch pleased God because he was righteous. He was righteous in his walk of faith, the way he lived before other people, that his beliefs and corresponding life conformed to what? God's word and will. Does your faith conform to God's word and will? That's the test. Not what other Christians are doing today. Many people say, well, look, I'm no different from any other Christian. But a lot of Christians today, their life doesn't conform to God's will at all. God wants your life to conform to his word. And that's your measurement. That's your rod right there. All right. Well, Enoch did that very thing. Second thing is, let's get it on the screen here. What happened there? All right. Enoch pleased God because he was a faithful witness. Now, we learned that in the book of Jude. Take a look on the screen there. It says, and it's important to see that very thing. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about them. About what? Seeing the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all of them of all the ungodly acts they have committed in their ungodliness and of all the defiant words the ungodly sinners have spoken against him. Boy, things were going bad in Enoch's day, and they are today. Because the world was filled with the ungodly. The world was filled not only with ungodly who shook their fist at God. They cursed God. They said everything they could do. They did everything in opposed to what God's word had said. So Enoch was up against this tremendous pressure in his life to conform to the ungodly world. Is it much different for you and me today? The ungodly world wants you to conform to them. And I want to tell you, I am embarrassed by the average church in America today, at least the large churches, because what they have done is conform their churches, their worship services, the way they dress, the things they do, everything to the godless world around them, and yet they claim to be believers. Go watch any of these services, you'll see exactly what I mean. People will stand up on a stage with their jeans torn in half and falling off their face. You'll see clothes that are so form-fitting on girls, you wonder if there's any clothes there at all. I'm not trying to be a hard case here, but I know this is true, and that is not being conformed to God's will or his word. And so I can only tell you what God says. He wants that for you, and he wants that for me. He wants that for our children. He wants that for your children or anyone else at that. All of these things are important here. And so what was Enoch? Enoch was a faithful witness. He was a preacher of righteousness. He was not silent when he went outside of his worship circle. He told everyone where they should be and what they should do. And I'm telling you now the same very thing. All right, the third thing we find is, let's get it up there. Enoch pleased God by daily walking in fellowship with him. Now, that's really important. Hebrews 11:5 says, by faith, Enoch was taken from this life so that he did not experience death, and he could not be found because God had taken him. Why? For before he was taken, he commended as one who pleased God. Enoch was the kind of person that read his Bible. Enoch was the kind of person who had a daily prayer life. Enoch was the kind of person who fellowshiped with God on a regular basis. He kept short accounts with his sin. Enoch was not sinless because he was a human being like you and me. He had a sin nature, but he put it in check and allowed God to check it in his life by walking closely with the Lord. You know, that's what God wants for you and me too. He wants us to walk closely, and the only way you're going to walk closely is that you have a devotion time, that you meet with God every day. I meet with God every day for at least four hours. And I want to tell you the truth. It's not because I necessarily want to meet with God. I do it because I have to do it so I can bring this message to you. But I'm so thankful that I do, because you know what happens when I meet with God in the morning? I get up at 3:30, 4 in the morning, and I meet with Him all the quiet hours. No one is up. No phones are ringing. Nothing is going on. My dear beloved wife is still sleeping. And I leave this world and I'm with the Lord. It is such a beautiful experience, and I can't tell you that you can have it too. Open your Bible. Read it, study it, and pray, and go through it quietly. And when God takes a verse of scripture and puts it in bold and slams it in your face, listen to it and see what God is saying to you today. That's what Enoch did, and it pleased God because he walked in fellowship with the Lord. How important it was. And of course, he prophesied and he witnessed faithfully. So Enoch was a man who pleased God. And because he did this and it was so wonderful, so faithful for these very things, let me get all these things back on the screen here. We go back to Genesis 5, 21 to 24. What does it say there? It says, when Enoch had lived 65 years, became the father of Methuselah. I'll go through this quickly. Enoch walked faithfully with God 300 years. I've only walked faithfully with God for 40 years. I can't imagine walking 300 years, but even that was cut short. Can you imagine that? He probably could have walked with God for 900 years. What a wonderful thing. But God said, all right, Enoch, it's time. I'm going to bring you home to glory. And that's exactly what he did. You know, Enoch struggled in this world just as you and I do, and I'm sure living in the midst of a terribly evil antediluvian world that God had to destroy. Imagine that. You know, and God is going to do that again in a different way. But nonetheless, God saw this and gave him his reward that was coming, that he looked for by faith. How wonderful it is. Now, the question we have to ask ourselves is, it says Enoch was taken by the Lord. The word taken in the Hebrew means an abrupt removal, an abrupt moving away from. We use the same word in what we talk about the church, the rapture of the church. There's coming a time when God is going to call all the believers on the earth home to heaven. Every single one of them, the good and the bad, the faithful and the weak of faith. Doesn't matter. If you're a believer in Christ, remember, you can't lose your salvation. He's going to rapture you right off the earth. And you will not die. You will be transformed in the blink of an eye. They say the blink of an eye is 1/1400th of a second. In the blink of an eye, you will be transformed into the glorious, new, majestic, and holy body that you will have for all eternity. But that, in a sense, partially, I have to say this, partially happened to Enoch. And now the reason I say partially is the glorified body, whether it's Old Testament saints or New Testament saints, will not come until the church is raptured. So what did God do? Well, let's take a look and see what we can come up with here. Now it says God took him. Where did God take him? Where did Enoch go? Well, he was forcefully carried away into what is called Abraham's bosom. It's called in scripture paradise. It is called heaven on earth, or heaven away from heaven. And the reason why is it's a place in the Old Testament called Sheol. That's the Hebrew word. Sheol is where everybody, whether they were a believer or an unbeliever, went when they died, because no one could go to heaven until the Lamb of God died for the sins of the world. All who believe their sins were covered by faith as they look forward by faith to the coming of the Lamb of God, which was Jesus Christ. But until he came, God had to put them in a place called Hades. Now, Hades was two types of place. Number one, it was a form of heaven for the believer. And there was a place of torments in there for the unbeliever, which was a form of hell. So in a sense, you could call it heaven and hell. Heaven and hell were in Sheol here, and it was called Hades. So I believe that Enoch went to paradise. And what did God do at that point? Well, he probably experienced what we believe today will happen to even the saints who die. If I die or you die before the rapture, we're going to be with the Lord Jesus Christ in heaven, not in Hades, because when Christ died, he went down to paradise. He took all the saints from Adam and Eve who were in there, and he brought them out of this heaven-like paradise to heaven, where they are for all eternity, and where you and I will be for all eternity as we await our glorified body. But now, are we there as wistful spirits? No, I don't believe so. Paul taught, and it's in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 to 4. He said, "For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, because we do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life." And he went on to say, "We have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens." We believe, the Church of Jesus Christ, theologians believe, that God is going to give us an intermediate temporary body. It's not the glorified body, but it's going to be like the glorified body, and we will not be floating spirits in heaven. And so Enoch is up there, Adam and Eve is up there, and all of them are up there, and Noah's up there as well. And we're going to see that that is what's going to happen until the rapture of the church occurs and Jesus comes again and brings us to have our glorified bodies. Now, will everybody receive the glorified body at the same time? No. There will be still some saints. Adam and Eve will still not receive his or her glorified body, but they will by the time that the seven-year tribulation period is ended, because at the end of the seven-year tribulation period, I'll move this way for you watching me. At the end of the seven-year period, that's when Jesus Christ returns to the earth, and there will be the judgments of the Old Testament saints, and they will receive their glorified bodies, how wonderful it's going to be. But it's important. Now, some believe that Elijah and Enoch are going to come back to the earth as the two witnesses in the seven-year period of tribulation. There's a very real possibility that God might do that, but I don't think so. I think Enoch is there to be. Elijah, well, he may be coming back. We'll have to see what goes on with that. But that's for another message and another time. Now let's move on. Hebrews 11:7. We move to another man named Noah. Noah, when warned about things not yet seen in holy fear, built an ark to save his family. And by his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness, that is, in keeping with faith. Now, it's really important to think about this, and James says it very well. As the body without the spirit is dead, faith without deeds is dead. Now, we've talked about faith and how you need to exercise faith in who God is and what he did through his son, Jesus Christ. But you'll never be able to exercise that faith without some action. And the action is really important, because what the first action is, that you will surrender your life and everything you have, and everything you are, and everything you do to Jesus Christ and say, "Oh God, come into my life. Take me, take over. Forgive me of my sins. Give me that new heart and that new life that I can live for you. I am yours, and you are my great God and Savior." That's what it means to believe in Jesus Christ. So anyone who hasn't believed that way, they're not a believer in Jesus Christ. They're fence straddlers. They're what they call the unbelieving believers. Can there be such a thing? Yes, we talked about that. Even Jesus said that. He couldn't give himself to those who trusted in him because they didn't believe rightly. But let's go on with Noah. Noah's faith is really a beautiful picture of our faith. Noah's faith is involved the whole person, the whole of his inner man. His mind was warned of God. That's what happened when we preach. I'm warning you by giving you facts and figures and truths and understandable intellectual things. You can know the Bible because we're teaching it to you. Well, his mind was warned of God. What does it say? By faith, he was warned about things not yet seen. You have been warned about things not yet seen. The coming of Jesus Christ to judge the world. You have been warned that when you die, unless you have Christ in your heart, you will perish in hell for all eternity. You are being warned in this life. Noah was warned, and he did something about it. He had fear of God. I want to say to you, unless you have the fear of God in you, you'll never believe. Unless you have the fear of God and what he can do to you and will do to you if you don't trust in him alone for your salvation, you can never be saved. Noah had fear. So his mind was warned of God. Now this fear does something. It starts to touch what we call the heart. The heart. His heart was moved with fear. Isn't that something? Yeah, in holy fear. And that's an important thing too. Now sometimes we wrongly, I believe, try to move people with fear. You know, Billy Graham, God bless this man who is in the presence of God right now, and of course receiving his full reward, I believe he will. He worked on the principle of a lot of evangelists of his day, that we need to get people excited about and believe in God. And so they started to use worldly things to get people to believe. We started to use organs playing and pianos playing and choirs singing, "Just as I am without one plea." I love that song. But listen, that plea will never get anybody saved. You know that? Nor will it ever cause anyone to be saved. But we started to use those things in big rallies. And then we had people come forward. I was in part of a Billy Graham rally one time, preparation for it. And we were told, get a few people that when we ask them to come forward, even though they're saved, just walk forward, because it will encourage other people to walk forward if they see somebody walking forward. Think about that. Do we need to use earthly, physical things to get people saved? The answer is no. I'll tell you something. When I heard that I was a sinner and I was going to hell and Jesus Christ loved me and he died for my sins, I was in my car, I pulled over to the side of the road, and all I could do is cry out, "Oh God, save me." And I want you to know, if I was sitting in a seat, in a chair, in a church, or anywhere else, I didn't need to raise my hand. I didn't need to walk an aisle. All I had to do was just pray in my heart. "Oh God, I've moved with fear. Come in and save my soul." And friend, I'm so thankful that 40 years ago, plus, he did that for me. And I've never lost the wonder or the joy of it all. But with his mind, he was warned of God. In his heart, he was moved with fear. And what did he do? He acted and he built. He built an ark to save his family. Now, can you imagine what people must have thought of him? He had gone stark, raving mad. He built an ark where there was no water. There was no rain in that day. Everything was watered from the ground up in mist. If people thought there was going to come a flood, they laughed their sides off at him. And why did he build it in a desert-like area? He knew that God told the truth and he was going to save his family. Now, how long did it take him to build that ark? Over 100 years. And you know why it took that long? Because God wanted him to be a faithful witness for him. So Noah's faith of action was what? A working faith. A working faith. If you're saved, you will begin working for the Lord. You will begin using your gifts and your talents, whatever it is, maybe in a local church, in the fellowship of God's people, helping out and working and building. Maybe you will help out on the mission field. Maybe you'll go out in the mission field. Maybe you'll go to a Bible college and study the Word of God and become a preacher for God. You will do something for the Lord. And it's so important. Noah's faith was an action faith, and it began working in him. Read Genesis 6, 13 to 22, and you'll see all about it. God gave the dimensions of the ark, how big it was to be, and what it was to be to build, like, and so forth. And it's interesting, God told Noah that a flood was coming. Two floods were going to come. You know what the first flood was? It was already there. the flood of evil. Evil had fallen in, and the corruption was worldwide now. And the corruption had not only fallen on Cain's family and the whole world of ungodly people, but, and this breaks my heart, and I'm sure it broke God's heart more than mine, it had fallen on the believing families. They failed to pass on their faith. Oh, there were certain ones that did carry on the faith, but the rest of them fell away into apostasy with the ungodly world. I think we're seeing that today. I talked to my brothers and sisters here, and we discussed the very same thing. Where are the third and fourth generations from us going to be? I wonder if they'll even be saved anymore, because each generation seems to have a fluff faith, a faith that, you know, it's just lightly there. It has no bearing on their lives other than they feel good and they like to sit in the church and worship or sing or dance around. It doesn't really matter too much. But they have a world of friendships without Christ and perfectly okay. Well, the important thing here is Noah lived in the world that was the sewer of apostasy, and he still kept himself pure and perfect. And of course, it's important to think about that. And I'm going to put on the screen here. Here is the lineage of from Adam and Eve. Adam, Cain, all the way down, the ungodly ones, all the way down there. But here was the godly ones, Seth and Enos and Canaan and Mahalalel and Jared and Enoch and Methuselah, Lamech, and then right down to Noah. And Noah, of course, passed his faith on to his three sons. Now, I put this circle here to show you that Noah was actually the great-grandson of Enoch. And if his son, Methuselah, hadn't passed on the faith to Lamech, and Lamech hadn't passed it on to Noah, there would be no one to save on the earth anymore, and God would have had to have destroyed humanity. But God did that and kept them going, and how wonderful it really is there. Now, of course, what was Noah called to build? Noah was called to build an ark by faith, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear, built an ark to save his family, but not only his family, because the Bible tells us in Genesis that God was going to bring to him pairs of every creature moving on the land that God determined he wanted to preserve. God did not preserve all the creatures on the earth or every species. God determined he was going to save certain species, and that's what he did. Now people say, oh, did he bring huge dinosaurs? No. If he was going to bring anything, think it through, my friend. He would bring the little babies, a male and female baby of a special creature. That's what he would bring into the ark. And God was the one who did it. Noah didn't have to do anything in the process there. He just had to, by faith, build this ark that the world would laugh at him for doing that very thing. So the flood of evil and corruption was worldwide. Apostasy had infiltrated every descendant from Cain's unbelieving family to even Seth's family along the way. And the second flood was going to come, a flood of judgment, a worldwide global flood that would cover the highest mountain peak by at least 20 or 30 feet high above the highest peak that was going to be there. And God said he would destroy all life on the earth. Look at Genesis 6, 7 to 9. I will wipe from the face of the earth the human race I have created, and with them the animals and the birds and the creatures that move along the ground, for I regret that I have made them. But Noah found favor or grace in the eyes of the Lord. This is the account of Noah and his family. Noah was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. So he was not only like his father, Lamech, and Methuselah, and Enoch, he was also a man who walked and worked for God. How beautiful it was. Look what Peter says. If he did not spare the ancient world when he brought the flood on its ungodly people, he protected Noah, who was what? A preacher of righteousness, and seven others, that is his family here. And Hebrews 11:7 says, he condemned the world by being faithful to preach the truth. Not only had salvation been provided and proclaimed, but saving faith through Noah had been demonstrated. Now, isn't that amazing? If you're a believer in Christ, the one thing God wants to see in your life is the demonstration of your faith before the unsaved world. It's important that you demonstrate your faith in some way. Peter, by divine inspiration, speaks of this very thing of Noah. And of course, mankind was so wicked. What did God say? Genesis 6:5, every inclination of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil all the time. Isn't that amazing and terrible how it is? But faith in Noah was seen working. Now, Noah was no less common than anyone else of his day, but he was an uncommon man because of his faith. And there were no others on the earth left at that time, except Methuselah. And that's important there. Now, Noah witnessed by words, by life, by actions, and all these things pointed to a dynamic working faith. A working faith. Oh, I wish we could see that in the church today. Faith working in the lives of all the people who claim to know Jesus Christ. And you know what the writer said? Because without this faith, it's impossible to please God. Because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. We just went over that before. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen in holy fear, built an ark and he saved his family. And his faith condemned the world. Now, of course, think about this very thing. It's important here. Abel showed us faith worshiping. God wants to see that in your life too. A worshiping faith that actually believes and, of course, puts it to the daily worship of God through your own personal daily home life to fellowshipping with God in the church. Now, you can't do that now in many churches, but you can do it online. You can be sitting on your couch in your easy chair and perhaps just listening to this scripture, or you can even watch us online. And if you have a smart TV, I know this, you can watch on the biggest screen you can imagine this very presentation here. And we put music with it, singing hymns of faith, and even some of the more modern songs as well that we think are appropriate. So you can have worship in your home, because the worship isn't with other people. Your worship is with God. But God does want you to worship with other people when you're permitted to do those very things. And we're going to come together very soon. So Abel is faith worshiping correctly and rightly. And of course, Enoch shows us faith. What is he doing? He's walking and witnessing with God in a nurture. He was a godly man with a godly family who raised up a godly son named Methuselah. You know, God said that the flood would not come until Methuselah died. And God enabled Methuselah to be the oldest living human being. Now that's grace. That's God's grace to hold back the flood until the full length of Methuselah's life ended. And when Methuselah's life ended, God brought the flood. Now, just think about it here. How about yourself? Ask yourself, how's your family? Does God stand out in your life? Does God stand out in your children's lives? Does God stand out in your daily life, in your work, in your worship, how important it is? Noah, think about this. Noah turned his entire life, his work and investments. Nobody gave him money to build that ark. And I don't know about you, but in probably today's money must have cost many millions of dollars. But Noah invested his life and the priorities to follow God and his purpose for him. And the truth is, there's no other way for you to follow God in that way. Now, I'm not telling you how to do that, but I know God will if you ask him. If you ask him, what do you want me to do with what I have, what I can do, please instruct me and help me. And as you get into the word personally, I'll tell you, there's verses in the scripture that are going to come out and slap your face, because God is going to speak to you when you read through the Bible. And how beautiful it is. That's how God speaks, through his word. Now, think about these three men, and it's important there. Enoch shows faith walking, Abel showed faith worshiping, and Noah shows faith working. How beautiful it is. So, why not invest your life in God, in Jesus Christ, and enjoy the benefits he gives you? Now, the promise is the blessings and the benefits are future. You're not going to get them in this life. But you know what God does say? By the way, if you follow me and you obey me, and although the blessings are in the future, I'm going to give you little blessings and gifts in your life along the way. Little ones for you. You'll really enjoy them. And every true believer who walks with God can tell you about those blessings. So why not turn your life over to Jesus Christ right now? Where you were, wherever you're sitting, whatever you're doing, just say, oh God, I want to be a believer like that Pastor Dennis is talking about. I want to be a Christian like this. Please make me that kind of Christian if you will give me the Lord Jesus Christ. Boy, he will. He'll turn your whole life upside down. So faith worshiping, faith walking, faith working. All three things God wants to see in your life and mine. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray that all who are listening today have all three of those things working in their life. Maybe one of them is not working too well. Maybe one of them seems to be almost not there. I pray that they'll work on that now with your help, Lord, and they will bolster that up so that faith worshiping, faith walking, and faith witnessing, all of these things will be there. And you will make them faithful, godly people that serves the Lord. And I pray, Father, if there's anyone out there who doesn't know Jesus Christ, maybe they've tuned in or listened in because someone has asked them to do that. I pray that today, just as I did some 40 plus years ago, as I pulled over to the side of the road, I saw Jesus clearly in my mind's eye. I understood that Jesus loved me and died for me, and I wanted him to forgive me of my sins. And all I needed to do was to ask and invite him into my life and surrender my life to him. And I did. And I pray others will do that as well. So bless the word. And we ask this in Jesus' most wonderful name. Amen. Well, friends, there it is for today. I've given you all I could put together. And I hope you tune in again next week because we're still in the book of Hebrews. And there's a lot more good things to see in these 16 people that God is going to show you what pleased him about believers. God bless you. Well, friends and beloved of God, that concludes our internet service from A House for His Name. I trust and pray the Lord has used it to encourage you who walk by faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And for others, perhaps today is the day of your salvation and true commitment to love and serve Jesus Christ. God willing, I'll talk with you again next week. And meanwhile, ask that you stay safe and follow our nation's health guidelines for interaction in your community. And may the Lord bless your heart and life and families as well. Till then, bye for now.